Okay, hello everyone. Thank you for tuning in. We have another video today, and we'll be focusing mainly on fitting brand new replacement rotors today, which I've got from DBA Australia. I'll also be doing an oil change, but I probably won't show that. I mean, we all know how to do an oil change. That's pretty straightforward. So I'll just be using the Royal Purple 10 weight 40 again, along with the liquid moly engine flush before I drain the old oil out. Also a new cane end filter, I think. It's what they call the gold series. It's a HP 1008. It's the same one as I used last time, the white one there. So that'll go along with the oil change. Pretty straightforward. I have got a little bit of extra oil from last time left over, which you know, I need the extra 600 mils for the oil cooler. So 5.5 liters, I believe. Anyway, so that's that. I'm not probably really going to show much of that in the video. While I'm under the car, I'm going to also just check my washer fluid lines. I think I've got a bit of a leak in my washer bottle or one of the washer fluid lines somewhere. So I'm going to check that out while I've got the car jacked up as well. Again, I probably won't really show that on the video. I don't really think it's necessary. But what I will be focusing on is the brakes. So what we have, I've ordered the DBA 4000 series, T3 4000 series slotted rotor. It's a direct replacement for the factory rotor, as far as sizing and fitment goes. So as you can see, this one, it's slotted. They are non-directional, so it doesn't matter which side you put them on. Which also means when you're ordering them, if you do order them, you don't need to order a left or a right side. They're non-directional, so it will fit on either side. It doesn't really matter. So we're swapping those over there. So it's quite heavy. That's going to be good. Hopefully it shouldn't go too hard. So in the box, of course, you get the rotor, the box here, a little sticker, which is cool. Some instructions and special notes there, warranty information, some packing, and that's it. So that's what comes in the box for the 4000 series T3 slotted rotors from DBA Australia. For the two of those, they're about $500 for both. I ordered them in from a local store. They're pretty much the same price online, give or take. I mean, it's much of a muchness. Again, I prefer to shop locally if and when I can. As far as brake pads go, that was really the tricky part. I have mentioned and spoke about this before. All in all, I think what I'm going to focus on is initially sticking with factory pads. Why, you might ask? I still need them to work on the street. You know, I drive this car more on the street than what I do on the track. And I'm hoping that, and I, you know, I didn't have a complete failure at the track with the brakes, so as they are from factory. So I was hoping that the upgraded rotor might disperse that heat a little bit better, and hopefully the gripping power and everything like that will, they'll be a bit more effective. So, you know, therefore I can retain the factory pad at least for the time being. So these were about $130 for the front pair, straight from the Nissan dealer. You know, so that's that. I've also got some Penrite brake fluid, stick with the Dot 4, stick with what's meant to be used with the car there, as far as I've researched. Some brake cleaner, some wire brushes for cleaning, and you can't quite see it, but over here I have jigged up a run-out gauge as well. So I'm going to check the factory rotors for run-out first before I remove them, and then of course check the new rotors for any run-out once I fitted them. So anyway, that's that. I'll get the car jacked up. We're going to do the oil change as well, and we'll get started.
I'm also a drummer, and they use these for tuning drums as well. So I've kind of rigged it up using some it should be pretty right as it is there, if any. So we'll start by taking the front wheels off, checking out the run out on the factory setup, and then we'll go from there.
Really handy having a rattle gun to get this off, so it's nice and quick, and you don't need to loosen the wheel before you jack the car up. So we'll start by taking it off. Also, this socket has this little white plastic sleeve on it. It's specifically for doing lug nuts, so it protects your rim if you've got nice rims. Kind of a cool idea. So we've got that off. I'll just lift that wheel off. So part of the process when checking run out is making sure that this doesn't have any play in it this way, or basically any play in it at all is the idea. So once you've got the wheel off, you put the lug nuts back on just so they're firm, so the brake rotor doesn't move at all, basically to simulate having the wheel on there. So the reason we check run out is I already know that from driving the car there's no brake shutter or wheel wobble or any play in steering or anything like that, but usually that's what checking your run out helps determine, whether or not your brake rotor itself is warped or anything like that and needs replacing, or it might even be the hub underneath the brake rotor that's needing some attention as well. So that's basically the idea behind checking run out there. So it's freely spinning now. So now what we do is bring in the run out dial. We set it to about 10 mil in from the outside edge of the brake rotor for the needle on the run out dial, and we start spinning the rotor and see if there's any movement, and the needle, the gauge on the dial will tell us that. So we've got the dial set up on the rotor here. So basically we just start spinning the rotor. Always spin the rotor clockwise as well. That's just a rule of thumb. So we just start spinning it. We're on exactly on zero on our dial. And we just spin it one full revolution. And we watch the dial for any movement. Okay, so that's a full 360, and we've had next to no movement whatsoever on that needle. So I'll run it again. I'll point the camera to the needle so you can see. Okay, so as you can see, we're perfectly on zero. I think from the camera angle, the needle looks slightly off the zero, but when you look straight down on the dial, it's definitely on zero. So just keep that in mind here, that that's not incorrect. So let's turn it clockwise. And as you see, there is the minute movement. So that is, I've done, several full 360 degree revolutions, so I'm pretty happy with that.
motor off. To take the caliper off, brake lines, and then the rubberized brake line down over the back here. So we want to take this whole caliper and this plate here off, and then you know, hook it up onto maybe a Okay, so to get the brake pads out, you can see these tiny little pins at the back here. We'll take those out with some pliers, nice and carefully. Take both of those away. There are new ones supplied with the new brake pads, but we won't lose them anyway. Then we slide these little pins out. And they do. So there's one pin there. It just slides out. And then the bottom one also. Also just slides away, and this little metal piece comes out, and then we can slide out our brake pads. Now they still look pretty good. Set that one aside there. And that one aside there. And now the caliper itself can come off. It's quite dirty, we will clean that before we put it back on. For now, we just take the caliper off. So there's those, and then over the back, two very large bolts, which are, the back are 22mm each. I might use my impact wrench to get those off as well. Then our entire brake assembly just lifts away. So we've got the caliper out of the way, just sitting behind the rotor. I've just zip tied it up to here. That seemed to be the easiest thing there. So that's just sitting really nicely there. We basically take the lug nuts back off, and then using this little screw here, that'll help push off the old rotor, and we can check out what the hub condition is like. So you take that off, take this little spacer away, and then I believe you screw the screw back in, unless the hub just happens to slip off, which it's not. Put the screw back in and you tighten it up, and it helps push the rotor off, I believe. Yes. And there we go. Just carefully lift that away, revealing the hub, and there's the old rotor right there, quite heavy as well. So we'll check out the hub in a moment and give it a clean up. There's definitely a bit of rust residual stuff there, so we'll give it a bit of a brush up and we'll take it from there. Okay, so now the actual hub itself is exposed. You can see there's some residual rust on that. We want to get that off before we put the new rotor on, so just a simple little wire brush, we just start by scrubbing it off. Like, you can just run over it with some fine emery paper. This is an 800 grit, just to get that last little bit off. So that's that. As you can see, it's nice and clean. I might just give everything a bit of a wipe down, clean all this other dust and residue away before I put everything back on while I have the opportunity to do so. So I'm not going to use any chemicals or anything like that. I'm just going to rub everything off with a dry cloth. That's all it really needs. Okay, so pretty happy with that. I didn't need to go too crazy with cleaning everything up. I just wiped all the dust away. Obviously, this is a nice, clean, shiny metallic surface. Yeah, so some of you might have thought, you know, to use a rotating brush tool, like a Dremel or an air tool or something like that, to clean the rust off around here. I would recommend against it, mainly because they spin so quickly, they tend to gouge into things, even with a soft brush or a soft sanding paper on them, so which digs into the hub and therefore, you know, affects your run out, which we were talking about just before. Generally, I would check the runout on the hub as well, but you saw the rotor itself was, you know, barely, it was perfect. So we have no need to check the hub for runout. We would have known if there was a problem by the reading before. So now we'll move on to putting on the new rotor. So we've got the new rotor here. That's the old one there. All you really need to do is just give it a quick wipe down with brake cleaner before you put it on the car. So we'll do that now. Tear it open. It's a pretty cool looking rotor, as you can see. Pattern in the front and in the back. And we have some paint markers on here, and they change colour to white, depending on different heat levels of heat that might get put into the rotor. So we'll just give it a quick clean down and then we'll be able to sit it on the car. To help remove any the oils and whatnot which, you know, occur in the manufacturing process of the rotor, which protect it in transit and things like that. So it's just a simple matter of placing the new rotor on the car like that and just hold it on with some lug nuts so it stays in place while we fit everything back onto the car. On there. Because it is a direct replacement, it fits straight on and it looks great as well. It also has the little hole there for our removal screw and sleeve, so we can put that back in where it's meant to go for future use. So we're going to fit the caliper back on in a moment. These are the two bolts that hold the caliper in. We're going to just put a couple of drops of the blue thread locker on these main bolts to make sure nothing goes wrong with our calipers, with them coming loose or rattling themselves apart or anything. So we'll just make sure we put some of that on as well. Now the caliper is fitted back on. The rotor still spins freely, which is good. Looks great as well. So now we'll put the pads back in. Here come, cue the hate comments. You can see how much meat is on those already. So, you know, honestly, I'll show you the new pad as well, and just so you can see the difference. I don't think I'm going to put the new ones in. I know it is rule of thumb that we do it anyway, but honestly, under the circumstances, I don't think it's necessary, but I'll show you anyway. So, here is one of the new pads,
and the one of the other pads that I've taken out already. So you can see already they are literally almost identical. The amount of meat on them is pretty much the same. So honestly, I don't feel it's necessary to change the pads at this point. In fact, it's probably better that I save them just in case. So we'll try and put the old ones back in, we'll see what happens, but you know, if it goes wrong and something really bad starts to happen, or shudder or noise or anything like that, I've always got these new ones here. So we'll see what happens. Now we're in. That is it. So now it's just a matter of, I'll screw this brake line back down, screw that on, put the wheel back on, and we are done. We move on to the other side. So there you have it. It was a really simple fit. This was just one side. Obviously it didn't take too long. It takes a little bit longer when you're making the video to go with it. I didn't go into too much detail, maybe not like I usually would, but it really is a pretty simple exchange basically. So I'll get everything out of the way, we'll do a quick check for run out again, and we'll wrap this one up and do the other side. So now we're set up to check the run out on the new rotor. So I've got the dial set up there again. I'm not sure how the needle might look, it might look a little bit off from the shadow and the angle of the camera again. Also keeping in mind we have the grooves in the rotor itself, so it will jump around as we hit those because they're unavoidable. But we'll go again, clockwise motion. Okay, so we've done two full 360 turns there, and really, really happy to say we've got perfect zero run out. So this is a absolute ideal situation for an install, particularly with rotating parts like this, to do with the drivability and stability of the car, the braking, and all that. So this is an incredibly good result. So we'll move on to the other side and see what we get there. On the other side of the car, with the runout gauge and the stock rotor. So we'll give it a spin and see what we come up with here. So far no movement. And that's really good. So we've done two full 360 moves. We've cleaned up the rotor. So we'll just stick that on, pretty straightforward. It just slips on again, like so. And we'll just use some of the lug nuts to hold it in place while we finish the rest. Now remember, as I mentioned before, just put a little bit of a blue thread lock on the main bolts that hold the caliper on, so we don't have any disasters there. Just a quick little bit, you don't need much. So all in all, like the doing the disc is something anyone with a little bit of confidence and know-how can do. I did sort of mention I didn't go into great detail, maybe like I usually would with the videos, but it is pretty straightforward. As long as
did reuse the original brake pads. The really had plenty of meat still left on them.
Thanks for hanging in and getting through that video. I obviously had a handful of camera issues with things cutting in and out. Do apologise for that. So just want to get this wrapped up, basically. So yeah, to summarise the whole thing, it really was an easy install. Just a matter of swapping one rotor out for the other. Like I said, it's fairly straightforward, so long as you've got a little bit of experience and confidence, and obviously the tools to do it yourself. It's not that hard. So, but if you're not confident, or you don't have the tools, or you do, or you are having a lot of issues with brake shuddering and shaking and things like that, might be best to definitely take it to a professional. So, you know, in my case, I was lucky. I did check, you know, I did measure things before and after, as you saw, and things were looking great. So that was that. I've since making the earlier part of the video and this part today, I've had the brakes on the car, the rotors, that new setup on the car for a few weeks now, and everything's fine. Before I installed those rotors, on the last track day I did before that install, I got a bit of information here, which I was planning to use for this video. So at the end of a 90-minute session, our front brakes, I'd come straight off the track, parked straight away, and took a reading. My front brakes were really tame, actually. Like, they were the sort of lowest I've ever gotten for a while. Anyway, our front brake rotors were reading 97 degrees Celsius. And our rear brake rotors were 150 degrees. So there's a huge difference between the front and back there. And that's on a factory rotor and a factory pad. So I will definitely update you guys on the potential changes in that on my next track day, which was meant to be today, but it got cancelled, unfortunately. So I'll keep you up to date on that. In regarding the brake pads, yeah, I guess I kind of explained it. It's easy for people to maybe button bash over the internet and say this, that, and the other. But honestly, if you saw the pads that came off, you'd honestly agree it was not a bad thing to do to reuse them. And everything has been fine since. Like, I've had no squealing. I've really kept an eye on the rotor itself. There's no grooving, there's no sign of anything bad or negative from me making that decision so far. So that was that. The other thing I did do, which I definitely regret now in hindsight, and I guess I did read up and research about it before I did it, but it was a cheap mod and I did it anyway, just to see. But I had all four tyres filled with nitrogen. Yep, there's a lot of videos out there, there's a lot of for and against, this, that, the other. I did read a lot of for, you know, a lot of pros about it, and I did also read a lot of against. You know, it was $5 per corner to get done, so it cost me $20 all up to get four tyres done. I didn't think it was a huge loss either way, and I also didn't think it could have been that bad, you know. I didn't really think it would be such a major thing, you know, a major problem. So what I did, and you know, and the people that were pro nitrogen filled tyres say, you know, that it holds its tyre pressure consistently for longer. It won't fluctuate in pressure when the tyres get hotter or colder, so on and so forth. So they reckon it's just more consistent all round, basically. And obviously, you know, air leakage and whatnot. From first-hand experience, I completely disagree. I had the tyres filled at 32 pounds, 32 PSI,
all four tyres. And that was at the dealer, where at the tyre place where I got it done. I checked them the morning of the track day, again, 32 pounds. And then I checked them immediately after coming off the track, after a 90-minute session. And there was a huge difference. So my front tyres went from 32 to up to 35 pounds. So they rose 3 pounds, the front two tyres. The rear tyres rose from 32 pounds up to 36 pounds. So they rose 4 pounds, which is a fair bit. I know, comparing that to another time where I had just had the normal air compressor air in the tyres, and I did the same, you know, I checked them before and after, and they'd only really fluctuated like 2 to 3 pounds front and back tyre. So they were, they'd fluctuated, but a less amount than what they did with the nitrogen. So, you know what, like, I should have just saved my $20 and not bothered with it, because honestly, it's just a waste of time if you ask me. There was no consistency, as people had claimed. There was no improvement, or there's no nothing, basically. So I don't agree with the nitrogen in the tyres idea, personally. So that was that as well. Anyway, so I'm going to wrap this up. Thanks for watching. I've got another video coming with where I run through cleaning and washing the car. Just a bit of a basic overview. I've been promising it for a while. So I'll try and get that up as well. I'm in the process of moving house, so I've got a lot going on, but you know, I'll try and keep this rolling when I can. So stay tuned. Thanks for watching. Share, subscribe, like, all the things. Thanks. See you later.